today we're going to cover how to grow the most exciting thing that I've ever grown in my personal garden. And it all starts with this right here. Some of you may have already known when I pulled this bag out, and some of you might have been able to read that tiny text. But basically, what we're going to be talking about today is growing mushrooms from spawn. And in this particular case, we're going to be growing the red wine cap mushroom, also known as a king stropharia, which is a quintessential garden mushroom. We'll talk a little bit about it, but I'm really going to be talking today about how to prep and build a bed for growing your mushrooms. Really quickly before we continue, let's talk about the substrate. In this case, you see that it's called sawdust spawn, and that's because the medium that it's growing in right here is all sawdust. The other option is a grain spawn, and that's made with things like wheat, oat, barley, berries. And what they do is they inoculate those grains, and that's what you use instead of the sawdust, which works well in applications where you could protect it. But if you're doing an outdoor grow, you want to make sure you get sawdust spawn because things like rat, mice, etc. won't eat it. So in the past, I have successfully grown two types of mushrooms, and that is the oyster mushroom and the red wine cap mushroom. So this bed behind me over the summer was growing oyster mushrooms, and that was quite rewarding. I think I'm definitely going to do that again and probably do it in the spring. In San Diego, I have a harder time finding wood chips, which is one of the most common substrates, and substrate is like a growing media. It's hard to find a lot of those hardwood wood chips that you find in places that actually have trees besides palm trees. So I mostly do straw beds because it's easier to find straw for me. And straw works well for pretty much most mushrooms. Well, definitely works well for oysters and wine caps. But just the caveat is that if you use straw, it goes faster, like it won't last as long, and they fruit faster. So there is the advantage of them fruiting faster, but usually the straw is something that's so easy for the mushrooms to break down that they'll rip through it in a couple months, and you get your first fruiting, and that's it if you don't properly maintain it. So we'll talk a little bit about maintaining your mushroom bed as well as building it. Before we move on to building the mushroom bed, I just wanted to mention that oysters and red wine caps are probably the best starter mushrooms for anyone who wants to try growing mushrooms. And the reasons are that A, they fruit pretty reliably, they're pretty easy to build beds for, and B, most importantly actually, is that they're very easy to identify. The red wine cap mushroom doesn't really have anything else that could be misidentified for it, so you don't have any fear or concerns of accidentally harvesting a poisonous mushroom and eating that. The oyster mushrooms as well are generally very easy to identify. So between the fact that they're easy to grow and more importantly, easy to identify, I highly recommend that if you did want to go down the path of growing your own mushrooms, which I highly recommend, that you go with the red wine caps or the oyster mushrooms. So now let's go build the bed. One of the cool things about building mushroom beds is that you can build them in places of your garden that you usually don't use. And what I mean by that is that you could build it in areas that get way more shade than most plants actually want. So today I'm going to do a little hybrid of that. I'm going to build a mushroom bed in this asparagus bed, which I just pruned back for the winter. I'm also going to build a different one in an area that I have nothing growing in that's almost always shaded. Using underutilized space, and in this case with the asparagus bed, I'm going to be boosting my asparagus by inoculating it with mycelium while also growing mushrooms. So I'm very excited about that. So let's talk a little bit about the growing substrate itself. In this bed, I'm actually going to be using garden straw, which is something that we sold at Epic Gardening over the summer. It's a straw product that's been processed so that it's cut up into very small, tiny pieces, and they've actually been split in half. So there's a lot of surface area, and that's gonna mean that the mushrooms are gonna have a lot of space to colonize. So I'm really excited to try that out. In the past, I've just used regular straw from a straw bale. No issue whatsoever with that. Actually, the reason I'm using this, I'll admit, is that I ripped the bag open and it got full of rain. So the straw's already wet, and that's actually ideal. When you build your mushroom bed, if you're using straw, you want to soak it for like a day to make sure that the straw gets totally saturated in water. It'll make the colonizing a lot easier. So in this case, it was actually an accident, and I'm going to turn that accident into a bonus. So without further ado, I'm going to go ahead and start spreading some straw out, and I'll show you how to spread the spawn after that. So I actually lied a little bit. I'm gonna actually start with a standard straw bale. And the reason is that I was thinking about it, and what I've realized in the past is that a lot of my mushroom beds actually get sort of wrecked by earthworms. And that's because they really like eating the straw, which is why it's such a good amendment in your garden. but they really made the mushroom bed last a lot less. Like it died a lot sooner than I expected. And when I dug it up, I looked and it was all worm castings, which is great for another reason. But this time I'm gonna give them a little decoy food. So I'm gonna start with a base of regular straw from a straw bale, and I'm gonna water it in. And from there, we'll apply the garden straw and inoculate this bed. All right, so now we have the base layer down, and you'll notice that I kind of tamped it down with a fork, and I watered it very deeply because this wasn't pre-soaked. So I wanted it to have some amount of moisture, but now let's spread out that garden straw that's already wet. We'll make a nice even layer, and then we'll get into the spawn. All right, so we have our spawn out. It's looking really well inoculated. And what I'm gonna do now is sprinkle it across the bed, put some more straw down on top, and repeat the process. What we're doing here is taking the spawn that's fully inoculated in this sawdust and sort of breaking it up so that we could propagate it. So what I'm gonna do in this bed is put down half of this spawn, and then I'll do the other half in the other bed. Or actually I'll do a little more than half here because this is a bigger area. One of these 5.5 pound bags is enough to cover about 50 square feet, according to the manufacturer. And I'll put a link to a couple options of places to get mushroom spawn in the description. But they recommended that this can cover 50 square feet for a 5.5 pound bag. So in total, I'm working with probably closer to 30 or 40 square feet in the two areas I'm doing, which is fine. Because I think the more spawn you put, the better your chances are. There's the first little layer, and now I'm gonna go ahead and do another layer of straw. One of the most helpful tips I could give you guys is that A, you want your spawn to be entirely buried. Make sure that it's not exposed to light, because that will kill it by drying out. And B, you really, really wanna make sure that the media is wet. So you wanna make sure that the straw that you're putting down is entirely wet. You wanna basically treat this mushroom bed like it's any other vegetable, where you give it that classic inch of water per week. So if you start off with a very wet bed, you're going to have a much better chance of success in the long run. All right, we're gonna sprinkle a little bit more only. I've decided that I don't wanna actually put that much more, but I do wanna put another layer. And then I'm going to do the final burial in regular straw, because I'm actually running low on garden straw. Kind of under budgeted how much straw I needed here. That's all right. As long as you have some other substrate to use, you can make it work. So this is really kind of a light coating. I don't actually know if this is going to be accomplishing much, but any sort of extra spawn will be hedging your bets. I won't show this because it's not that exciting, but what I'm going to do next is put a sprinkler over here for maybe an hour and make sure this gets entirely soaked and all the straw has a chance to soak up that moisture. So with that, let's go move on to the other bed. So you'll see that I'm kind of hermit crouched into this dark little spot, and that's because this is an ideal mushroom growing bed. This is where I had my red wine cap mushrooms grown last year, and I mentioned that the earthworms kind of ate all the straw. So there's still a little bit of straw left, but it's very thin. So I'm going to rejuvenate this with that last bit of spawn. And at the end, I'm just going to time-lapse this because as you can see, it's a kind of a hard spot to film. I actually decided to get some regular straw and bury it a little deeper. And what I'm gonna do now is kind of step on it. So I wanna make sure that it's all compacted and there's actually contact with the mushroom spawn. So I'm gonna do this and water it in. Sorry for the poor lighting, guys, but in winter you take what you can get. Mushroom bed is now completed. I have it fully built, fully hydrated, and now I wanted to talk about this last little bit, which is protecting your mushroom bed. Now, I said at one point that mushrooms don't like to be in full sun. They can be in full sun, but if they are, they have to be protected because the bed will dry out so fast that the mycelium will die. So in this case, you'll see that the sun is hitting me right here, and that's west, that's east. So these mallows will actually provide shade for the morning sun, but the afternoon sun is the more intense one, so we want to protect against that as well. So what I have here is two bamboo stakes and a old coffee bag that I bought from my local coffee roaster for $1. And so I have it hung up on there, and all I'm going to do is sort of drape it across like this. In this case, I happen to have a fence here, so that's gonna hold it up, but that's gonna basically provide it shade throughout the day from the afternoon sun. There you have it. We built two wonderful mushroom beds. You could see just how easy and quick it really is to build a mushroom bed. It's not really that intimidating or scary at all. It's really just getting the right supplies, whether that's straw or the right type of wood chip, and getting a nice spawn. And that's really all there is to it. I just wanted to share a couple more tips, sort of how to protect and ensure you get a longer mushroom fruiting cycle. First thing is that I've really become a fan of burlap coffee bags. You can get these for free or very cheap from your local coffee roaster. And the nice thing about it is that they allow water to flow through, but they also will reduce evaporation and keep the temperature of this bed lower because it's blocking the sun from direct contact. So this will ensure that the mushroom mycelium network can get robust enough to the point that once you remove this in, say, like a month, which is my plan, that it will have the right conditions for fruiting those mushrooms that you have actually put in this bed. The other thing I wanted to mention is that you want to make sure that you're giving your mushroom bed at least 1 inch of water a week. You basically treat it like any vegetable. I think a lot of people fail with their mushroom beds just because they don't actually water it as much as they really should be. Final little tip is that if you are building a primarily straw-based mushroom bed, it's really important that once you get your first fruiting, that you add a lot more straw right after that. The fruiting is basically the culmination of all the efforts of breaking down all that straw that you started with, and it's going to be reduced to almost nothing. And it's not really enough to sustain the mycelium network to keep going and to have a second fruiting. So once you fruit your bed, you want to make sure that you add basically another 3 inches of straw on top. And that's going to ensure that you can get a second or maybe even third fruiting if you keep feeding it. But expect your mushroom fruiting cycle to be in periods where you have like abrupt changes in weather, such as a lot of rainfall events, big temperature swings. Those kind of things will trigger the mushroom to want to fruit, to sort of same idea as like any vegetable or a fruiting plant like a tomato. They're producing those tomatoes so that they can ensure that their genetics are carried forward so they could grow more tomato plants. The fruiting bodies of the mushroom are the same thing. They're the fruit that's providing more spores so the mushrooms can spread. So you want to make sure that you keep those things in mind, protect your mushroom beds, water them, and rejuvenate them. And with that, that's all there really is to talk about right now. Hopefully in the spring, I'll have a nice, huge harvest of wine cap mushrooms. If it's interesting enough, I'll try to turn it into a video. If not, please follow me on my Instagram, and I will definitely be posting it there. I can't wait. It's really one of the most rewarding, exciting things I've ever done in the garden. So until next time, Garden Hermits out. Thanks for watching.